What a great way to end the day here with Hillary Clinton coming up in a moment. I want to first thank Alan Murray, who all of you saw this morning, is just a wonderful moderator. Has been a wonderful partner to the Shared Value Initiative and the Change the World list. So glad to have Alan back this afternoon in conversation with Hillary. You know, I have a rhetorical question for all of you, and it's a serious one. How does one introduce Hillary Clinton? Yes, I've been thinking about this for a couple of weeks, seriously. I had a couple of options in mind. Number one, I thought, well, I could talk about her biography. I could talk about what has been a lifetime of public service, literally decades working to the advancement of others at all stages of her career and life. But I didn't think I could do that justice in 5 minutes. And right before I walked up here, they told me I actually only had 3 minutes. So that wouldn't work. I could talk about our extensive relationship with the Clinton Global Initiative, the linkages between our organizations. The SVI, where you are today, was launched as a CGI commitment in 2012. Very proud of that. But that didn't feel quite right either. So I thought, well, I could go the personal route. I'm the father of three little girls. Girls that my wife and I spend as much time as we can pointing them to the examples of strong, successful women. Of course, women just like Hillary Clinton. But none of this seemed just quite right to me, and so I didn't know what to do, and probably like a lot of you, when I don't know what to do, I go into learning mode and I ask others. So I convened a panel. It's true, I convened a panel over breakfast last week, and I have to set the stage for you. There's Lego waffles, there were some bagels, some people requested them with cream cheese on, some to the side. And it was with my three daughters, Grace, who's 9, Lucia, who's 7, and Vivian, who's 5. And I said to them, girls, I will have a chance next week to introduce Hillary Clinton at our summit. And of course, their first response was, well, why? And what are you doing there? And I said, okay, Dad's asking the questions. Just. But I need some help. And I said, girls, can you tell me one word to you which would describe Hillary Clinton? And as any of you know who are parents, harmony at home, let me just say, is often a little bit elusive. But they all agreed on one word very quickly. And they said, Dad, the word is courage. So I decided that the best introduction that I could provide to Hillary Clinton was a quote about courage and hopefully what she means to many of us who are engaged in this work and shared value. And I found a quote from Martin Luther King Jr., and I'll read it to you. Courage is an inner resolution to go forward despite obstacles. Cowardness is submissive surrender to circumstances. Courage breeds creativity. Cowardice represses fear and is mastered by it. Cowardice asks the question, is it safe? Expediency asks the question, is it politic? Vanity asks the question, is it popular? But conscience asks the question, is it right? And then there comes a time when we must take a position that is either neither safe nor popular, but one must take it because it is right. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Hillary Clinton.
Secretary Clinton, I sat up here this morning and no one stood, no one clapped. They didn't do anything for me.
But they have now.
But thank you so much for being here and being part of this conversation. I want to start with There's a page in your book where you say, if I had been elected, here's what I would have done. And you talk about the infrastructure problem, you talk about the job training problem, you talk about green energy. And I think the question that we're dealing with in this room today is, can the private sector pick up the slack there? How much of that stuff can the private sector do? Because the companies in this room consist of companies who want to see if they can make progress in that area.
Well, Alan, I certainly think that the private sector can pick up a lot of the slack. And I'm hoping that it will, because just the problems that you mentioned that I did write about are urgent. And they have a dramatic impact on our economic growth and our future shared prosperity. So it isn't possible, I don't believe, to pick up all of the slack, 100% of the slack. But I think it's imperative that more and more companies do. For example, you mentioned clean energy, and I've been personally very relieved that a lot of companies have said, we're going to keep moving toward clean renewable energy, despite the fact that we were pulled as a nation out of the Paris Agreement and now have the dubious distinction of being the only nation in the world not in the Paris Agreement. So the more that businesses themselves can continue doing what they were doing for efficiency reasons as well as impact, and work in partnership with cities and states and other countries that have the same shared goals. Same with infrastructure. You know, just last Friday, I gave a speech to something called the Regional Planning Association here in New York that puts out a report every 4 years about infrastructure and planning ideas. And of course, it's especially important in a place like the tri-state area because a lot of our infrastructure is old and aging. And there's one particular project called the Gateway Tunnel, which some of you may have heard of, which is to build another tunnel under the Hudson River because we have two 100-year-old tunnels. Now, realistically, if you are looking at the economic impact of this area on the entire national and global economy, it's significant. It's about 10% of the entire United States. And so in a smart way, you'd be planning for that. Now, that is not a project that business alone can do. But business can speak out for that project, can explain why in economic terms it's very much in line with the bottom line. So I think in these areas of incentives and really necessities, prerequisites in some cases, for continuing and accelerating economic growth, as well as dealing with other problems like climate change, I think that business can do a lot, and I would hope that many would see that and follow through.
And this, of course, is the same line of thinking that the Clinton Global Initiative was involved in for a decade. This is similar to what many of the people in the shared value movement are doing. Did you see over that period a steady increase in business interest?
Really, very much. I mean, you know, the Clinton Global Initiative was at root a way of bringing different groups, different interests into the same arena and then finding and promoting ways for people to cooperate. So lots of private sector businesses, not-for-profits, governmental entities. And it was exciting because very often, in order to make a social impact with a product or a service that the business already provides, you do need to get out of the C-suite. You've got to get out and meet other people who can come up with creative ways of utilizing whatever it is that you are offering. And we saw that, you know, just time and time again. And some of it was, you know, very much in line with the shared values concept of what can we do to make a contribution with the product that we have. So you have a Procter & Gamble with a clean water component, and they have some market for that, but really the people who need it the most are the poorest people in the world, and they're not exactly a big part of the market, so how do you bring that about? And they partnered through the Clinton Global Initiative with charities that help them bring their product into very remote places in order to provide potable water. And then eventually some governments paid for that. So, you know, it's not a huge moneymaker, but it is a great way to use something that has been invented as a result of the intellectual capital of a company for purposes for people that would otherwise be left out.
You know, one of the changes that has happened that's kind of surprising and interesting. I mean, when you first entered the political arena, people thought of business as being part of the Republican Party and labor as being part of the Democratic Party. And now, as you point out, businesses on the more progressive end of some of these issues, like climate change. What does that tell you?
Well, it tells us that we're a very practical people, and that we need to encourage that practicality, because what we should be focused on is solving problems. And that requires bringing everybody with a good idea under the framework of shared values to the table in order to brainstorm, work together, and reach a result. You know, it is an unfortunate consequence of our highly partisan atmosphere right now, that people are at loggerheads over a lot of these potential opportunities. So I would hope that through events like this, through the FSG commitment to shared values, more and more companies and potential partners would understand why this is important. I'll give you an example, two examples, quick ones. When I was senator from New York for 8 years, I learned there was this big disconnect. You had one of the most highly productive agricultural sectors in any state in upstate New York and on the far end of Long Island, and you had one of the biggest food markets in the world here in New York City. But they were not connected. And it struck me as a failure of networking. And what I began to do, using like the Cornell Ag School, was to bring together farmers and producers from upstate New York with food brokers and restaurants from New York City. And it didn't take a whole lot for them to be sitting at the same table and all of a sudden having one of the food brokers say to the farmer, well, we don't buy corn from this part of upstate New York because you put it in burlap bags instead of crates. If you put it in crates, we'll buy it. Well, nobody had ever shared that information. And we began a big effort to try to open lines of communication and literally put people at tables to be able to have that conversation. When I was Secretary of State, I started the first ever global partnership initiative aimed at solving problems. And one of the big problems that we addressed was the impact on cooking in causing respiratory diseases that were actually the fourth leading cause of death in the world, mostly among women and girls who were bending over those cook stoves, you know, breathing the fumes of wood and dung and other materials, and using open fires to prepare their meals. So we said, look, there's got to be solutions to this. And there was a really small effort called the Global Cook Stoves Alliance. And what we determined to do, and friend and colleague Chris Balderston, who's here, ran that office for me, we began reaching out to a lot of companies around the world and reaching out to countries and saying, you can create a market with cleaner, more affordable, reliable cook stoves, but you have to spend the time to research that. So the cook stoves for northern China were not going to be the same as the cook stoves for sub-Saharan Africa. And now there are hundreds and hundreds of members of this alliance and dozens of companies that have created a market.
And it's a profitable business.
And with, you know, it's not a big margin because people can't afford it, but it is building a business and creating that market.
Yeah. So the other thing we were talking about this morning with Deval Patrick, who was here, is the fact that that you also now see CEOs speaking out on social issues. If you think about what Ken Frazier of Merck did after the Charlottesville riots, resigning from the President's Council, Ed Bastian at Delta, canceling discounts for the NRA, Bank of America taking a strong stand in North Carolina about transgender access to public bathrooms. Those are all issues that I'm pretty confident, having watched this thing for a while 10 years ago, none of them would have done.
Right.
What's going on there?
Well, I think children are talking to their parents, number one.
which is a good thing.
Which is a good thing, because a lot of these issues are really at the forefront of profound cultural and social change. In addition, I would mention REI, which said they were no longer going to buy products produced by the manufacturer of the AK-47, Dick's Sporting Goods, which said they weren't going to carry AR-15 and other automatic weapons, and we're going to raise the age for purchase to 21. Walmart followed suit. And I think part of it is a very strong movement that has gotten stronger since the election, really, by people who are using their energy to, you know, speak up and make their point. And Starbucks, with dealing with a very unfortunate and unacceptable situation in one of their stores, closing their stores for a day, which, you know, is clearly a money loser for them, but they're going to try to do a better job of dealing with bias and discrimination. And I think part of it is that there truly are a lot of pressures now on CEOs that weren't there. Mm-hmm. One of the advantages of an online world is that people can highly organize quickly to make their views known. And most companies follow social media pretty closely because, you know, one bad review, one hit on a product can have ramifications far beyond anything that was possible 10 years ago. So there are many forces at work, but I also think on some of these issues, the CEOs themselves are among the many millions of Americans who have evolved and understood a broader definition of human rights, civil rights, women's rights, gay rights, the kinds of issues that are very much in the atmosphere.
So the interesting thing about that is that at the same moment that you have more and more companies joining groups like the Shared Value Initiative, you have leaders feeling a need to project that they're doing good in the world because of the pressures you've talked about. At the same time that's happening, faith in capitalism is clearly declining. You've seen the polls, particularly among young people, but in your own party, in the Democratic Party. I mean, you were challenged by a self-proclaimed socialist. We thought they had died in the 1990s, and there he was. How do you deal with that?
Well, I have to say that the reputation of capitalism is pretty much in tatters for young people. And for people who feel disadvantaged and damaged by the last financial crisis. So in Iowa, for example, which obviously is an important state in the selection of nominees for president, a very clear indication of what was happening was that 41% of self-identified Democrats also self-identified as socialists.
What was the percentage?
41.
Wow.
Yeah. And then if you look at millennial polling, it's over 50. It's over 50%. Okay, so why is this happening? Well, look, I mean, this is the subject of a lot of great work by Michael Porter and Mark Kramer and others. But I would say from my perspective, business is so pressured now by market forces and by what I believe to be the upending of what corporations used to think about as the audiences that they were serving. Al and I were talking backstage. I mean, you can trace the growth of the primacy of shareholder value two articles written by Milton Friedman and then many others starting in the 60s and the 70s, where what used to be the balancing of various factors within inside a corporation, and a corporation, remember, is a creation of the state. You know, you have to be chartered by a government to be a corporation. And the historical view was, you know, you do have to pay attention to the communities you're working in and serving, to your employees. You do get rewarded, or should, for long-term investments that are not going to pay off in the next quarter, maybe not the next 4 years, but are smart to make. That was all turned upside down on its head, and I think that was a great detriment. And then, of course, once that became the reality of most CEOs' lives, then it just picked up on an accelerating basis, so that, you know, your annual report became your quarterly report. Your quarterly report becomes your monthly report. Your monthly report is, you know, practically down to a weekly and maybe a daily report, where that's no time, that gives you no time to breathe, let alone plan and invest. And I don't think that our legal system, I don't think that our governments have really paid appropriate attention to trying to figure out how do we get the balance better. So now, like here with shared values, we're asking companies to add that on top of all the other pressures, and hopefully and thankfully a lot are, but the basic structure is not as friendly as it should be to the kind of social, political, and economic changes.
So how do we get the balance better?
Well, I think you need good examples, like what you're doing here, some of the companies that are here, some of the decisions that have been made. But I think we you know, when I was a senator, when I ran for president, I had countless conversations with CEOs. And not just the enlightened ones that were going to support me, but others as well.
That's the definition?
It was always a fascinating conversation, and some very big names of people. It's exhausting. It's really difficult to run a public corporation right now because of all these competing demands and the relentless pressure that is brought to bear by activist shareholders, by raiders, people who could care less about the long-term value of the corporation, could care less as to whether you ever trained employees or, you know, researched and developed new products. They are looking for whatever the return can be, as high as they can possibly see it. So I think a lot of company leaders are fully aware of this, but feel trapped by the environment in which they find themselves.
Yeah, I mean, I can tell you, a Fortune 50 CEO said to me at one point last year, you know, if we don't fix this problem, the shared value problem, if we don't convince the next generation that this system works for society, we're gonna lose our operating license. I mean, are we at a crisis point for capitalism?
Well, I think we're approaching it. I do, because the growth in inequality, income inequality, has clouded over the positive aspects of growth and development and personal and community advancement that capitalism has brought.
Yeah.
So that people are saying, what have you done for me lately, and what are you going to do for me tomorrow? And I don't see it. What I see is a lot of high visibility actors who are basically trying to increase the wealth that goes to the top 1%, who took the tax cut claiming it was going to turbocharge investment, increase wages for employees, go into new plant and equipment, and basically it's going into stock buybacks and maybe some dividends, but it's not producing.
You don't think it's going into investment or employee
payout? Not at the rate it was promised. I mean, there's very little evidence of that. You know, maybe there's more going on than people are reporting on, but I think that the promise of that, which could have been a turning point for American capitalism. You know, I recall when I was a senator, we had the first Repatriation Act, remember? And, you know, we... I had a steady stream of CEOs coming to see me from companies, you know, in New York and around the country. And they all said, we're gonna, you know, we're really gonna use this, we're gonna make these investments. And even George W. Bush now says it just didn't happen.
Yeah.
It did not happen. And you know, the money was brought back at a 5% rate, as I recall, and went into buybacks.
There's some evidence that it may be happening at a higher rate now, in part because we're at a point in the economic cycle where companies actually need to invest.
Yeah, they might have very well done it without, but they
have some cash to do it with.
Yeah. But I think the extent of what's needed is not happening. In order to persuade these people that I think you're rightly identifying as giving up on market capitalism, I think that there has to be a more concerted effort and a public commitment by a lot of companies to do that.
Do you think CEO pay is an issue in that equation?
It always is an issue. And I mean, you know, the increasingly high ratio of CEO pay to average employee pay is a constant irritant. You know, when you get to 200, 300, 400 times what the median or average is, yeah, that's an issue. I mean, democracy and to a great extent, capitalism really depends upon trust. You know, people have to trust. They have to trust the business they're doing business with, and they have to trust the government that governs them. Trust is the glue that holds a democratic market economy and democratic political system together. And right now, it's badly battered. And a lot of the, you know, a lot of the actions that are being taken by people in the business world just are blaringly insensitive to people who are out there looking at it happening.
You may be the only presidential candidate since World War II that actually had to stand up and say, I am a capitalist. and you did. Did it hurt you?
Probably. I mean, you know, it's hard it's hard to know, but I mean, if you're in the Iowa caucuses and 41% of Democrats are socialists or self-described socialists, and I'm asked, are you a capitalist? And I say, yes, but with appropriate regulation and appropriate accountability, you know, that probably gets lost in the, oh my gosh, she's a capitalist.
I mean, even
but I did, you know, I talked about my father, who was a very, very, very small businessman. I mean, really a small businessman. And you know, I watched how hard he worked, and I watched how that hard work was rewarded, and that he gave us a very comfortable middle class life, which was, you know, really a great benefit to me personally. So, yes, I mean, I support hard work, I support risk-taking, entrepreneurial energy, but we're out of balance right now. I mean, we are way, way too much toward the biggest companies, the ones with the most influence, and too many of the people in the corporate world are using their funds to really disrupt and undermine our democracy. So it's a kind of double hit.
Well, let's talk about our democracy, because as you know, Michael Porter has said that the biggest economic problem we have is the dysfunction in our politics. And that dates back to some time. I mean, some people would look at 2011, the inability to come to a budget agreement in the face of a debt downgrade was, well, we can't even do that. How do you see us getting out of this? What's the path out of the dysfunction?
I will give you a very simple partisan answer. Change the Congress in November. Elect Democrats.
That doesn't really get us out of it.
But I'll tell you, it helps, Alan, and here's why. So there is a pattern over the last 40 plus years where Republican presidents spend us into debt with big tax cuts, big expenditures, and Democratic presidents, my husband and Barack Obama being Exhibit A and B, come in and have to do some really tough, heavy lifting. Balancing the budget, getting us to a surplus in Bill's case, dealing with the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression and spending a lot of money to kind of lift us out of that in, you know, Barack's case. So I think, and I don't, we should never be where we are right now. I will be the first to say that. And when I was a senator, I worked with practically every Republican on something. I did. And so I really believe the country works better when we have two strong, functioning parties, but
that can work together.
That will work together, that will try to find some common ground. But unfortunately, the pressures on the Republican Party now are so intense that Republicans who I know better. I know they know better. I know them. I've worked with them. Are pushed into these corners where they are not acting in their constituents' interests. They're certainly not acting in the long-term interests of the country. And we're going to have to rebalance our politics for a while and try to show that we can once again make decisions. You mentioned 2011. I was Secretary of State. I was in Hong Kong in July, the first time the threat was made to shut down the government. And I was speaking to like the equivalent of the Chamber of Commerce. And all these business leaders were coming up to me saying, is your government really going to shut down? And of course I said, oh, no, it's just political grandstanding. Don't worry about it. It won't happen. Which, as Secretary of State, I thought that was the right thing to say.
Probably thought it was true.
Well, in July, I thought it was true. And when you get to a point where the greatest economy in the most long-lasting democracy is going to be deliberately damaged, undermining the full faith and credit of the United States of America, we are in serious trouble. And unfortunately, there's too much of that kind of thinking, and it's not well-informed, it is not evidence-based. So I think we have to work our way out of this electorally and try to break the hold that the right and ideological and commercial interests have on the Republican Party to try to get back into some better balance.
Well, you can argue the chicken and the egg and who went first and who drove it, but there's no question that, I mean, we were just talking about it, your party as well is backing itself into a corner.
And they should recognize what that will mean because, you know, I come from the school of thinking that I don't have all the answers and I don't believe that anybody does. And therefore, what we need to do is listen to each other and try to hear what is being said and then look for this common ground, similar to what businesses that are interested in shared values are doing as well. The problem is that, you know, that's not very exciting. I mean, when you think about it. I mean, I've worked so hard to have sensible, smart, effective policies and how we would pay for them, which I do think is part of the obligation. And oh my gosh, what a yawn. And it was, I kept waiting. There will be a moment when it will actually matter. How you're going to fund your infrastructure project, because we were both advocating for infrastructure, for example, never came. And so if our politics is moving more into reality TV show land and entertainment, that makes it even harder, Alan, because people who are seriously committed to working together are going to find it harder and harder to be heard and to try to create those coalitions that are needed to get anything done. Yeah.
Who's your 2020 candidate?
I don't have one. every time I'm asked that, I say, 2018. You know, we had the cart before the horse.
We had Deval Patrick here. You think he's a potential?
I am not commenting on any individual.
If I ask you three or four times, it won't change the answer.
It won't change the answer.
All right, let's take some of these questions then, because they'll do better than I'm doing. Can you talk about the power of women in driving stronger business? What do you think the role of diversity is?
Oh, I think it's everything. I mean, we now have evidence that diverse decision-making leads to better results. And we also have evidence that, you know, women in decision-making positions in particular bring a often a different perspective, sensibility, set of experiences. So it's imperative that we continue to diversify our workforce and our business leadership. You know, I spent a lot of time as Secretary of State talking about this because there's some really compelling research done by the IMF, the World Bank, OECD, Goldman Sachs, other groups that basically concluded all the same thing, that every country, including ours, is leaving GDP on the table because we have not empowered women to be more involved in business and be rewarded for their involvement. And in our case, it's about 9%. In some places, you can imagine in the Middle East and some parts of Asia, it can be like 30%. So if we're trying to figure out how we're going to grow the global economy, there are many things we have to do, but one of them is open the doors for women and other groups to have a real chance at being successful. And women-owned businesses are the fastest growing part of small business formation. But they don't get anywhere near the access to capital that men who start businesses do. You know, venture capitalists and other funders overlook a lot of women who have good ideas, have the sweat equity. So we've got to provide more support for true access to capital as well.
You, as Secretary, you've had the opportunity to see this around the world. One of the questions is how does the trust in businesses' ability to create shared value and have social impact vary by regions of the world?
That's a great question. I mean, I think that, you know, in the West, we consider Europe, Canada, the United States as making that up. I think that a lot of European countries have done more to try to influence decisions by businesses. For example, you know, some countries are mandating quotas for board members and mandating, you know, particularly women being brought onto boards. Some are mandating how their sovereign wealth funds will invest and how they can have a social impact as well as a financial reward. So I think there are examples that may not be applicable to us, but which demonstrate some places are much more sensitive and trying to be successful. Much of the rest of the world are not even debating this. I mean, it's not, and you, when you have a command and control economy like China, you know, businesses—
It's all national interests.
Yes, all national interests, security interests, yeah. Competitive interests. But it is true that I wouldn't call it shared values, but I would call it recognizing value that in China, you know, their investment in clean energy, they intend to be the biggest clean energy manufacturer and exporter, even though most of the innovation has been developed elsewhere in the United States and Europe, and we're just leaving that. We're not competing at all. So I think they may define value differently, but they view their principal value as continuing to raise incomes, moving more and more people into the middle class, and influencing global markets because of what they're investing in right now. So I guess they're, you know, Japan, when Prime Minister Abe first came in, he called me and he said, well, I want to do more to bring women into the workforce, because he looked at the same figures I just referenced, and he said, look, we've had a stagnant economy for a long time. If I can get women in the workforce, you know, that will provide a boost. But he ran into problems, because why aren't women in the workforce? Because they're taking care of children and they're taking care of aging relatives. And there is no social structure that has been implemented to provide those services. They also don't allow immigration. So they're an aging country and they don't have an incoming supply of young workers. So, you know, he quickly ran into some obstacles, but he had the right idea.
So question, how do we incent business to create shared values, and where should the pressure come from? We were talking about this earlier this morning. When I ask business leaders that question, they tell me their employees first and then their consumers. And as you said earlier, it's the capital markets that have been kind of last to the game. But is there anything you can do to change those incentives?
Well, I mean, I think there are a number of things that could be done. I think one is looking at how the pressure for quarterly returns is manipulated by outside actors to keep CEOs in a constant state of anxiety. I mean, that's certainly what they tell me. And some of the biggest companies in this country, their CEO said, you know, I'm always looking over my shoulder. I can't even look straight ahead. I can't figure out, okay, what do I do today, tomorrow, and the next day, because I've got people coming at me from behind. And I think we should do a very thorough vetting of our corporate laws at this point, because we know what has happened in the last 40 years. We're in this situation in part because laws changed as well as behaviors, and I think we should look at that. I'm not going to sit here and say I know the answers, but how do we get to more companies being incentivized to make long-term investments? You know, our primary tool is the tax code. Okay, we're going to let you write off this investment much faster, and maybe that will get you to do it. But I think there should be a more broad view about what might work. And then looking at different forms of corporate formation. So the B Corp is something that's just getting started. You know, maybe we should be taking a hard look at that and how many advantages can we incentivize that? Because it's a clear statement that you want to be looking for shared value.
You of course are talking to the believers here in this room, but what would your advice to them be when they go back to their companies on how to advance the cause?
Well, first of all, I think that what you're doing here is critically important, and you're really at the forefront of what I hope will be a movement. And trying to get your companies to do things that will produce results. Nobody's asking any company to make decisions that will undermine your fiscal well-being and take away your potential for growth, but look for those opportunities of, you know, making investments, of pursuing new lines of business that can make a real difference. I'll give you an example from New York. So, you know, Corning is one of the great New York companies, and I don't know if anybody's here from Corning, but I've done a lot of work with them as a senator. And they came up with a technology to clean diesel exhaust. And one of the big problems we had in New York and across the country is that school buses were primarily diesel in most places. And so the exhaust would often exacerbate asthma and other conditions among kids who rode on those buses. So I teamed up with some other senators, and we created a program inside the, as I recall, the Energy Department, to fund experimentation in outfitting school buses, because no school district could afford to go and buy all new natural gas clean buses. They could eventually, but not in the short run. And then we worked with Corning to accelerate their production because it was a win-win. It was going to help the company, but it was also going to help these school districts. And so if you're looking at health as one of the shared values, what can you do in your company to promote that? And obviously, different answers are possible, or clean energy, or environmental cleanups, whatever it might be.
So one last question from the audience. I've read what happened. I suspect many people here have. You know your account of the 2016.
If you haven't, better hurry up.
Or at least buy it. But what will you tell your granddaughter about the 2016 election and what it says about our society and the role of women?
Oh my gosh. Well, she's only 3.
So you have a little time.
Yeah. But I'll also tell my grandson, who's 22 months, I'll tell them both, to read my book.
We're looking for the children's version.
Yeah, the children's version. Well, look, I lay out in the book what I do think happened. And I finished writing the book last end of June. And everything since then has proven more and more that the factors that I laid out were really instrumental. But I have a whole chapter entitled On Being a Woman in Politics. And I wrote that chapter because it was, for me, a difficult experience at a number of points in the campaign because of the double standard, because of people's expectations, because of how the campaign would be covered. And I wanted to make the point that, yes, I had these experiences, and I lay some of them out in the chapter, but it's not just about me, and it's not just one candidate, one election, one time, because obviously I was well aware people would answer polling or reporters' questions like, oh yeah, I'd vote for a woman, just not that woman. But then, after I was not in the political arena, all of a sudden, similar things start being said about other women who maybe will run for president, or even if they don't, they're high profile. And I think we still have a ways to go. And there was just a poll in the last week or two which found that 60% of Republicans said they did not care if we ever had a woman president. In fact, they were perfectly satisfied with there not being a woman president. So, you know, there was some comparable, there was some people on a much smaller level in the Democratic Party who would say that. But when you have one of your two major parties basically saying it's not a big deal and all the rest, you can see how that adds burdens to women running to be our first woman president. So I would explain the best I could to my grandchildren. And, you know, I was raised by parents who said, you know, don't accept limits, work hard, learn everything you can. They never thought I'd ever run for president, neither did I. But the underlying message was the same. And I think we're at a point in how we view women where there is some pushback, and there is some, pressure on women at all levels of society right now. And you see that online all the time. If you're online and you're a woman, often you, if you are speaking out on politics or speaking out on equal pay or paid family leave or issues that are important to you and other women, you will probably have a pretty quick and negative reaction. So we have to make sure, and I'll do this the best I can with my granddaughter and grandson, you know, we have to develop confidence, resilience in our kids. And yet we also have to be sure that for both our boys and girls, they recognize that we can't live in an adversarial world and be as successful as we should be. The United States is better positioned than any country in the world to grow our economy, to lead politically and strategically, as well as economically and socially. The only thing that can stop us is ourselves. You know, not only the point that Michael Porter made about our own political dysfunction, but also about the fears that unfortunately are being fanned among people about change. You know, change is inevitable. You cannot stop it, but you can manage it. And you can try to figure out ways that it is more positive than negative. So I hope that we get back to problem solving, we get back to communicating, and that certainly is what I would tell my grandchildren or, you know, any young person in our country. Don't look over your shoulder. Look forward. You know, deal with the changes. Figure out how you can take advantage of them and not be crushed by them. And bring others along with you. Because if we do that, then I think we have reasons to be optimistic. But if we get mired into all this negativity and scapegoating and finger pointing and everything that we're seeing too much of today, we're doing the work for other countries. You know, we are giving great gifts to leaders who don't share our values, and really want to see the United States diminished. So we can't, in my view, afford to let that happen.
Secretary Clinton, thank you. Thank you. Inspiring message.